Well, hey there, everybody. And question, do you recognize our theme song for today? That is Ants Marching by the Dave Matthews Band. My apologies to them. I did not get permission, I'll be honest. Just wanted to play that little snippet of it because it seems so appropriate for today's topic, which is Fire Ants 101 for greenhouses and nurseries. Now, figurative show of hands out there. How many of you have unknowingly stood in a fire ant mound? I say unknowingly because you know it soon enough when the little suckers start to bite and sting. And growing up in Florida, I experienced that firsthand, and you quickly learn to watch where you tread when you live down south. And oh, by the way, they bite and sting, as you will soon learn. Now, today's expert has made a career of studying fire ants. In fact, he's such an expert, he's the guy the Weather Channel calls when they want to know why fire ants form rafts during heavy rains. In fact, he was on twice on Saturday. I caught him at the 7:20 airing. And he is Dr. Lawrence Graham from Auburn University. Welcome, Dr. Graham.
Good to be here.
Now, Dr. Graham, two quick questions. How long have you been studying fire ants?
It's not a career. I was a cotton entomologist and I actually studied the effects of fire ants in cotton, but I took over the program here in 1999.
And how many times have you stood in a cotton field and found yourself standing in an ant nest?
More than once. That's actually how I found out that they were very good predators of the beet army worm, by kneeling down one day, getting stung, and actually seeing the army worm disappear in the mound next to my knee.
And there are some benefits. I remember on Weather Channel they asked, fire ants do anything good? And they actually are a predatory insect. So there are some benefits to some of the agronomic crops down south. But my second question, you told me that nobody knows you, except maybe your mother, as Lawrence.
That's right. Your name
is Fudd. And I got to ask, how'd you get that nickname, Fudd?
That comes from growing up in a small town. I had a father who worked at the Chevrolet dealership. My uncle owned it. My dad's name was Chester. My uncle's name was Elmer, and I was either Little Elmer or Little Chester, and you can figure where the Fudd came from after that.
I see where this is going. All right. Oh, by the way, Fudd, did you know that it's Carpenter Ant Awareness Week?
No, I did not.
All focused on the fire ants. Forget those carpenter ants. That's somebody else's problem.
We're all going to learn something today.
All right. And by the way, who am I? Well, you know me. I'm Chris Beatty's editor of Growertalks, Green Profit, and Acres Online. And Fudd, you're broadcasting from your office down in Auburn. I'm up here well away from fire ant territory in West Chicago, Illinois. Now, a few housekeeping issues. So far, I have not gotten any notes from our attendees saying, why is there no sound, which is a beautiful thing. But for those who can't hear, I always pop this little slide up there since they can't hear me explain how to get on. I'm hoping they're reading this to find out, oh, you click here and click there, and then you're good to go. So but I think we've got that taken care of. We've got to thank our sponsor, BASF, who puts the free in free webinar. Thank you very much, BASF, for that. Now, as we go along, as Fudd goes along, if you've got questions, use either the chat area or the Q&A area over there on the right-hand side. If your question is kind of pertinent to what Fudd happens to be talking about, we'll catch it right then. I may have a few of my own, as a matter of fact. I think this is going to be pretty fascinating. If we don't get to it, hang on, though. We'll try to get to it at the end. We're going to leave some time there. And if it's too complicated to handle during a webinar like this, we'll provide some contact information for Fudd where you can get your questions taken care of. And if for some reason you get kicked off the webinar or have to take care of a customer or what have you, fear not. It will be archived by this afternoon. We're recording it right now. Let me double check. Yes, the recorder is running. Same place you sign up, allpublishing.com/webinars. So I think that's it, Fudd. I'm going to turn it over to you. I'm going to hand you the controls right now. I'm sliding the little presenter ball over, and I think it's all yours. So take it away, Fudd.
It seems to work on this end. I'll go ahead and skip the title slide since you know what we're going to do. But this is what everyone thinks of when you think of fire ants. And this is a famous picture we fire ant folks across the South have used for years of Bart Dries's boot from Texas A&M being covered in fire ants. But, you know, here in the South, we think football is pretty much the god and the things. And you know you have a pest when it can stop a high school football game or any other football game, and we have had fire ants do that. In fact, the reason we have quarantines is that fire ants are medically important. And in 2013, actually a football player was killed after getting by fire ants after he was stung, went into anaphylactic shock. So there is a medical reason that we have a quarantine for fire ants also. What I want to do during the day is to talk a little bit about fire ant biology. Pretty much if you don't know the biology of your insect, you don't know how to control it. So I'm going to go into a little bit of the history of fire ants, how they got here, what they do, how they grow, and then we'll talk a little bit further in the program about the quarantine and what you guys in the nurseries need to know about controlling fire ants. Oh, excuse me, went too fast, too far. Fire ants came here into Alabama, and I guess Alabama's famous. They came into Mobile, Alabama. There are two species. The blacks came in 1918, and the red imported fire ant came in sometime between 1930 and 1940. And when they first got here, people didn't think they were much concerned because we actually had native fire ants that weren't quite as aggressive as these guys from South America. We started developing problems around 1950 when actually the nursery industry basically shipped them across the Southeast because we didn't think they were a problem. In 1965, we determined there were two species, and since they are together here in the United States and they're not in South America, they actually created a hybrid between the red and the blacks. You can see the quarantine counties in the United States and which species is located where in this map. And in fact, we've actually got more detailed maps than that where you can actually take a look and see which counties have reds, which counties have blacks, which counties have hybrids, and which counties have maybe one or the other or all three. But we needed to know this for some of our research. And again, I mentioned if you don't know the biology of your insects, you're not going to know how to manage it. And I found that in every talk I've given, people don't know the biology of fire ants. So we're going to cover a good bit of that today. And one of my favorite ways of controlling fire ants, since one I recommend for most everyone, is baits. I know it's not going to be very involved inside your nurseries, but most people don't use baits because they don't understand how they work. And they don't understand how they work because they don't understand the biology of fire ants. So where does fire ant mound come from? Fire ants come from mating flights. About 24 to 48 hours after a rain, you'll see the winged forms of the fire ant boiling out of a rain if it's a mature mound. If you look at the bottom picture on the left, you can see a female alate. On the right, you can see a male alate. Those males, by the way, are the only males in the mound. All of the rest of the ants in the mound are females. These guys fly up into the air somewhere between 300 and 800 feet in the air, and they mate. And the female will fly back down. She'll gnaw off her wings, and she will start to develop a mound. But she is the most vulnerable at this time. She's vulnerable to predators, flying insects, birds, things like that. She's also vulnerable to her environment. If she lands on hot ground or hot sidewalk, she won't last very long. She's also vulnerable to poor judgment. That's why, if you've noticed, they come to pools, to bright colors. They are floodplain insects, and so they're going to go toward where water is, and so that reflection will actually fool them and have them ending up in places they don't need to be. And believe it or not, since most of our ants here in the South, and we'll get into this a little bit, are single-queened, they are territorial around their mounds. One of the biggest predators that we have of fire ants is other fire ants.
Fudd, quick question. I had to look up the word alates here. I'd never seen it before. That means winged, though, right? Winged version?
That means winged form. That's correct.
All right. And we have a question, too, from Virginia, going back one slide to the counties. She says why some counties would only have one type of fire ant. Is there a mechanism that keeps that county pure, or are you talking, or is it really a matter of there could be others on the borders, you just haven't found them yet?
There could be others on the borders. This was done from a grid we made across the southeast. A quick explanation of why we did this. We have released parasitoids of the fire ant that attack fire ants, and they protect different times of day, different ant behaviors, and different ants. Some prefer red imported fire ants, some prefer the black. And so before we could release these parasitoids, we needed to know which species was located where. And so we went into each county and found three mounds, selected those, took them back, and found out which species they were. So this is a static picture that was taken about 5 or 6 years ago, and I would suspect it's changed since then, but it gave us a look at that point in time of where we could release those parasitoids and predators.
Right. The borders aren't quite that clean cut and distinct, obviously.
No, and I don't know whether the hybrids are coming further south or the reds are coming further north. That's the question we've posed to one another at meetings, and we don't know that answer at this point in time.
All right. Very good. I'll let you go on now.
Okay, we've got the alates. So that lady's going to come down. She's going to drop back down to the ground, and it's pretty neat the way that they fly 24 to 48 hours after a ground when the ground's soft, because she's got to burrow down into the ground. And she'll start laying eggs at that point in time. She'll seal her chamber, and she's going to stay down in the ground for about a month, just laying eggs and feeding them. And after about a month, the first workers are going to come out, and they're going to be the smallest workers that are in the mound. They'll open the mound up. They'll begin foraging and begin construction of that mound underground, and she's going to start laying about several hundred eggs a day now that she has someone to come bring her food back down into the mound. And for the first 3 months, you may not see that mound. It will be underground. It will be invisible. And there are other times that mounds disappear during the year, too, especially in the hot summer when it's droughty. If these mounds get disturbed, if they get mowed, they won't rebuild that mound until they have new moisture. So during the hot summertime, it's difficult to find mounds. We found that to be true as we go out to try to put out fire ant tests. And that's why when you have a rain, all of a sudden these new mounds pop up in the yard. They appear suddenly after a rain, and you think new mounds have moved in. That is not true. They are mounds that have been there, especially if they're over 6 inches, they've been there for quite a while. Now, below ground, these ants are going to create a tunnel system, and they can have over 300 feet of underground tunnels. These guys can go 4, 5, 6 feet down into the ground, and then they will build up their mound. And these hilly mounds of dirt are especially important for fire ants during the wintertime because they act like solariums, little greenhouses, where they're going to collect heat to warm its residents in cool weather. So there's an advantage to having that mound there, too. Fire ants are what we call polymorphic. They have many size workers, and I mentioned earlier that the smallest ants in the mound are the ones that come out just after the queen starts the mound. Their function is going to depend on the age of the colony and what the colony needs, but their first job when they come out, regardless of their size, is they're nurses. They take care of the queen, and they take care of the young in the mound. Their second job is what we call reserves. They're the guys that come out of the mound and sting you when you step in it, and they're the ones that are taking care of the tunnels and making sure the mound's in good shape. The last job they have, which makes sense because it's the most dangerous, they're foragers. They go out and collect food and bring it back to the colony. They have complete metamorphosis, as a lot of insects do. They have an egg stage that you can see on the far left. The next three from the left are larval forms. The larvae develop into pupae, which is the second from the right, and then the adult is on the far right. When you kick open a mound, that white stuff you see that everyone talks about is what we call the fire ant brood. It is the pupae and the larvae. The eggs are so small that even if you have a clump of them together, they are very difficult to see just by opening up the mound. And that egg stage is going to last about 7 to 10 days. Once that egg hatches, it develops into what we call the first instar larva. And the instar is what we call the stages of development when they shed their skins. The first instar will shed his skin into the second instar larvae and so forth till they get to the fourth instar, which is the last one that they have. Now, this is an interesting development stage of the fire ant because it is the only stage of fire ant development that can eat solid food. On the picture on the right, you can see the on the right-hand portion of the picture where the arrow is, a piece of solid food in what is a pit right under the mouth of that fourth instar larvae. And they will actually either spit up digestive juices on that and it will develop into that pouch, or they will eat some of it and basically regurgitate back liquid food for other ants to come get. And this is basically where the proteins, the amino acids that are required for egg production for the queen and for the younger larvae to develop come from in the mound. And it's also an important trait you need to remember when you're looking at, I mentioned I like fire ant baits, understanding how they work. When the foragers go out, if you look at the line in the middle, if you go to the right-hand side and they pick up a liquid such as an oil, they will bring it back to the reserves at the mound, and those reserves will take it to the nurses, which feeds it not only to the queen, but to all stages of larval instar development at that point in time, because everyone in the mound can eat a liquid food. But if the foragers go out and get a solid food, they will bring it back and it will go directly to the fourth instar larvae. That larvae will digest that food, turn it into a liquid, and as I said, it has the amino acids, proteins, and things that the larvae and the need for development and that the queen needs for laying eggs. And so those foods are taken directly to the queen and taken directly to the larva, which is why the baits work as well as they do, because you do kill off the queen and you kill off the developing larvae that are in the mounds with the bait. Now, I mentioned earlier, too, that one of the biggest predators of fire ants are other fire ants. When that new queen flies down into a territory that a fire ant mound is foraging for food in, if they come across that queen, she doesn't smell quite right, and they will kill her because she does not belong in that area. And if you've heard the old saw that if you take a shovel full of ants from one mound and put them in the other mound, they'll kill one another, well, that is true. The ants that get thrown in that new mound will die because they don't belong there. That is if you have single queen colonies, in which is what we have mostly across the South. And in single queen areas, you have 40 to 50 mounds, 40 to 60, 80 mounds per acre on average. But in the early 70s, we found multiple queen colonies. These fire ant colonies have no territoriality. Their mounds are more stable, but they have greater mound density. In an area where you have multiple queen colonies, instead of 60 to 80 mounds per acre, you're going to be looking at somewhere to 150 mounds per acre. The workers of these multiple queen colonies are going to be smaller. Their queens are going to lay fewer eggs, but because you have so many more mounds out there, you have greater egg production over the area, and these guys are harder to eliminate than the single queen colonies that are territorial. You'll find some of these sporadically across the South, and there are a great number of them in areas in Texas. Now, let's talk a little bit about fire ant management. I have divided this into what I call two types of management. First is proactive, where we go out and try to do something about the problem ahead of time. Reactive is what you see here. This is an Arlo and Janice comic. She says, please bring the ant poison. She hollers at Arlo one more time. She says, thank goodness you heard me. He said, I didn't. The neighbors called. She'd been out sunbathing. This is when I get the phone call. I have ants in my yard. I want them dead, and I want them dead yesterday. And that's not the best way to manage your ant mounds. People call me up all the time and ask me what's the best way to kill my fire ants. And the answer that I give most of them is that it depends. Most people don't like that answer, but it's the truth. Management is going to be site-specific. What we're going to recommend for your nurseries today is a little different from what you're going to do at your home. And I found that no single strategy is best for all situations, no matter which fire ant you have or what kind of problem you have. As a general rule of thumb, if you're using a bait, I like to treat the fire ants after your spring mating flights, which in Alabama is May to June. Use the baits because they focus on gradual rather than fast removal of the ants, and these slow-acting baits tend to give longer control of the fire ants too. Again, as they're dying slowly, the ants that are still there act as predators and kill any new ants that come into the area, so they actually act as biocontrol. Let's talk a little bit about killing fire ants with insecticides now, and there are two main types. We have fast-acting residual contact insecticides. These mainly target the foragers when you spread them out on your property. The contact is limited to the colony and queen because they don't get carried back. They're just on the ground, and the colony, rest of the colony and the queen are down in the ground inside the mound. They do have residual activity depending on the rate, what your weather is. Higher the rate, of course, the longer residual you're going to have. And these products can be both granular or they can be liquid. The baits, on the other hand, are going to target the colony and the queen. I mentioned a while ago, when they get that solid food back, they feed it to the fourth instar, and then it is taken to the queen and to the developing brood in the mound, and it kills them first. Once you kill the queen in a single queen mound, you kill the whole colony. But it does take longer to kill the whole colony, and that's a problem that some people don't like because, again, when I get that call, they want them dead yesterday. And there's a bioresidual effect that I mentioned, too, and we'll talk about that again as we go along through the talk here. So let's take a look at using fast-acting residual contact insecticides as individual mound treatments. If you've just got a few mounds in your yard, this is one way you can go about taking care of your mounds. The advantage is they're fast. They're generally fast-acting if you put them on the mound. They're easy to use, and you minimize residues in your yard because you're only treating that mound. The disadvantage comes in if you're trying to treat large areas when you have a large number of mounds and you have to take time to search and treat all those mounds. And remember earlier I said during the hot summer months, if you have mounds that are underground, sometimes they're difficult to find and you will miss those invisible colonies because they're underground or maybe in tall grass. Sometimes it's difficult to access the entire mound, especially if they're along a sidewalk, where they'll build that mound underneath the sidewalk where they have a more comfortable environment to develop in. And of course, if you're going to put this products on the mound, most of them require a gallon or two of water to mix them in, so you have the hauling and mixing of that liquid also. One of the things you're going to do if you have an individual mound treatment is to make sure you get enough product down into the mound. This is what a mound looks like. And remember I said a while ago that underground portion of the mound can go 4 to 6 feet down in the ground. If you're going to do these treatments, I always recommend doing them in the winter and fall. In the summertime, you're not going to have as much luck. And the reason is, in the summertime, that sun's going to heat up the ground. And during the middle of the day, in the hot summer days, when the temperatures get above 85, up into the 90s and closer to 100, that ground is so hot, the fire ants will not come out and they will not forage. They're going to be, at that point in time, deep down in the mound where it's cool. So if you come out and you've got a hot, dry time and you put a couple of gallons of insecticide down in that mound, it's not going to go very far, and that queen's going to be able to escape out of the side tunnels. If you've noticed on a fire ant mound, the ants do not exit from the top of the mound. They come out from side tunnels that they use for foraging and other things. So that ant's going to be down in the ground. But if you treat them in the cooler months, from say October 15th to around April 15th, when you have cool nights and the sun hits the mound in the morning and it warms up, they're going to bring that their brood and the queen onto the top of that mound. So you're chances of taking out those mounds are much greater with individual mound treatments during the cooler months than they are during the hot summer months. You can also use these fast-acting residual contact insecticides as a broadcast application. They do slow reinfestation for a month or so, depending on your rate and the residual, how much activity your residual has. And you usually get rapid colony control for a time. The disadvantages of these is you do have to have complete coverage of the area when you treat the area. Some of these granular products may need to be watered in. You need to read the label for that. You can leave residues in sensitive areas, and most of these are non-selective insecticides. Not only do they kill fire ants, they kill everything else. One of the things that I like to recommend are baits. What is a fire ant bait? Well, it starts with a carrier. Usually that's a yellow corn grit. Then you add an attractant. In the case of fire ants, this is usually some type of vegetable oil. And then you add the active ingredient. And you put these all together and you end up with a bait. And hopefully when you spread this out in your yard, what you will see is one of the little ants picking up this bait, carrying it back to the queen, feeding it to her. That way you take the mound out for sure, because to get a mound and completely rid it in your yard, you've got to take out that queen. Some people do confuse granular insecticides with a bait. So if you want to make sure you're using a bait, you need to check the label and make sure somewhere on it it says fire ant bait. I always get the question, what about Talstar? Talstar is not a bait. It is a granular insecticide. There's some advantages to baiting. It utilizes the natural behavior of the ants to distribute the toxicant back to the colony. They're efficient to apply. It only uses a small amount of insecticide and growth regulator. Most of the baits go out at a pound and a half per acre. They're low cost. Again, your active ingredients carried to the mound by the ants, and there's little or no residue left because the ants do pick this up and carry it back. The disadvantages are the time you have to time the application to the ants' foraging behavior. And as I mentioned earlier, during those hot summer days, the ants don't forage during the middle of the day. So if you want to put out your baits, you need to put them out early in the morning or late in the afternoon. And with the bait, since they have to feed through the colony, like I mentioned earlier, with that fourth instar larvae, the colony control is going to take a while, 1 to 8 weeks. And they're difficult to apply at low rates without the proper equipment. Now, there are several different types of baits that we have. First are the metabolic nervous system inhibiting baits. I'm not going to go through all of these, but what I want you to notice on these baits here, they take 1 to 4 weeks to work. And the reason is these are definitely toxicants to the ant, and they have to be in the ant bait at a sublethal dose, so the ants wouldn't be able to carry them back to feed them to the queen and to the fourth instar larvae. So it takes a little bit of time for this product and the active ingredient to build up throughout the mound to kill the queen, to kill the young, and to kill some of those workers. There are, however, a couple of baits on the market that are a little bit different. They are basically probates, and as that active ingredient is carried back, it is not toxic in the form that they're carrying it back in, but once they take it in and they metabolize it, it becomes a toxic product. And so when it breaks down into those two products in the body, it will kill. So you can actually put more of this product in and get a faster kill with these two active ingredients. There are active ingredients, too, that are growth regulators. They kill the growing larvae. They make the queen lay sterile eggs. But they do not kill the workers. So those workers have to basically die of old age in the mound. So it takes a little longer for them to work. And again, if you're looking at that reactive stage, most people don't want to look at fire ant baits. This has to be set up on a proactive system. There is one product mixture on the market that has hydromethanone methoprene in it. And again, it still takes 2 to 4 weeks to work. Why don't people use baits more? Well, basically, they want immediate control. They want it yesterday. They don't understand how they work. That's why I went through the biology today. People confuse them with granular insecticides, and again, like I said, they are difficult to apply at these rates. I mentioned the bioresidual of this a while ago. This is the overall killing power of the insect control technology, including the direct effects that kill the ants, plus the associated natural biological mortality. That comes in with fire ants when those ants are dying slowly. They're dying of old age. New queens fly in, they prevent reinfestation, so that is your bioresidual. Your ants are preventing reinfestation as they die slowly. So there is some advantage to that, and they're not as aggressive at that stage either. These baits need to be applied between 70 and 85 degrees. If it's much hotter than that, they will not come out. So you got to do them in the summertime, early morning, late afternoon. If you do it early morning, you got to make sure there's no heavy dew out there. You don't want to apply these products if rain is expected within 4 to 12 hours. And you need to store your bait in a cool, dry place. If you remember, I said it has a vegetable oil on there as a carrier, and that vegetable oil will go rancid. And if it does, you can smell the bait and you can tell. You don't want to store these products with pesticides, gasoline, or any other volatile chemicals either, because the baits can actually pick up some of those odors, and that will make the bait less attractive for the fire ants. And you only want to buy what you're going to use each year. If you get a good sale on this and you can buy enough to cover you for 2 or 3 years, you don't want to do that. Again, that bait will go rancid because of the vegetable oil in the product. You only want to broadcast during the warmer months of the year. You can do individual mound treatments with the baits year round. I found out that. But during those cooler months, I don't think they go out and forage as much, and they won't pick up the baits if you do a broadcast application during the winter months. Again, you can go back and do those individual mound treatments that I mentioned during those times. The wonderful thing that we found out about 6 or 7 years ago is you can actually mix this with a fertilizer application. If you make your fertilizer up, once you mix it, you mix in your fire ant bait, and then you go out and immediately put that application out. You do not want to let this product sit inside a fertilizer. If you're going to broadcast baits, again, you can do small areas with the handheld system, but if you're going to do larger areas, there are only two products that I know of that can put out the baits at this low rate. One is a Herd GT77, and the other is a Vicon pendulum spreader, and no, I do not get anything from either one of these companies, but they're the only ones that I know of to put it out at large areas. Now let's talk a little bit about the quarantine that you guys have to work under and ship your nursery products with. The goal of this is to prevent the spread of imported fire ants within the United States. And it covers any related articles that can contain fire ants or fire ant queens or reproducing colonies. And what we're going to talk about today are plants and sod with roots and soil attached, basically nursery stock. It also covers hay and straw, soil moving equipment, bees. Actually, they're looking at recycled materials now that are being set on lots for a considerable time. So there are several different products that can be shipped that are covered under the fire ant quarantine. There is a zero tolerance by non-infested states for fire ants. Several years ago, we had a good summer for hay in Alabama, and there was a drought in Missouri. And that was the first time I had ever gotten involved with the quarantine, because Missouri would not take a thing from Alabama unless we had guaranteed that that hay was fire ant free. Those quarantine treatments must guarantee that they're going to eliminate fire ants from the commodity at the time of treatment, and then keep it fire ant free for some specified period of time. And we'll talk about that in our treatments here in a minute. So the commodity can be moved into a non-infested area, and they can be guaranteed that they don't have fire ants in that area. And one of the reasons for this is, again, goes back to that medical importance of fire ant stings with people being allergic to them. What you guys may not realize, and it's how I'm involved with the USD, is these quarantine treatments, we have to test these products. And it usually takes about 3 to 7 years of field testing prior to initiating USDA approval for these in your quarantine programs. I do testing for Anne-Marie Calcott down at USDA APHIS for mostly on grass sod products. Jason Oliver in Tennessee does most of the nursery testing, and Kelly Lofton in Arkansas also tests on nursery and in grass sod too. And we're the three around the South that do most of the testing of these products for the quarantine for nursery and sod. These tests have to come over multiple years, and we look at the efficacy and the residual activity over these years. If you've ever worked with fire ants, you can realize consistency is not something you're going to get when you put out a fire ant test. They are difficult, and something you did 1 year may not work the next year. So we've got to make sure that we test multiple years. And with your nurseries, they're going to test multiple medium types, containers, different soil types, and we've got to do this in different locations across the South too. This is a map of the quarantine areas that are in the United States, areas that are quarantined currently. And if you'll notice, this is a map that shows some of the areas, but you can see the whole counties are not quarantined. And this is of importance to the growers in those areas, because if they're not over the whole county, those growers don't want that whole county quarantined. Because if you're not in the quarantine area, you don't have to go through the regulations that you need to meet to ship products out of that area. So you can see why there are different counties that are not fully quarantined, but they have just bits and pieces of that county where they have fire ants that are quarantined. The reason that we do have the quarantine is the gray area is where the quarantine is now. The red area is the potential range of the fire ant in North America. And you can see there's about half of the country that is covered right now that can support fire ants. And so people don't want these coming into their area if they don't have them. The manual that yes, Chris.
Quick question. Is that strictly because of wintertime temperatures? Will they freeze out?
Mostly wintertime temperatures and rainfall amounts.
Okay.
And I say rainfall amounts because California has them in Orange County and Riverside County. And they told me out there that they would be able to control them because they have such desert conditions. And when we were visiting out there, I said, no, you don't have desert conditions. You actually irrigate the exits off the interstate. Everything was green. What, 109 golf courses in Palm Springs. That's not desert. That's perfect habitat for the fire ants. So it depends. You can take a condition that is not suited for fire ants and create conditions that are suited for fire ants.
And I was curious, when you said they can burrow so deep and kind of use that as a, you know, thermal protection, if
yes.
They actually maybe survive further north than we think.
That's true. If they can get in the correct place up north where they're next to concrete or cement or things like that, the problem with the fire ants is they've got they can't go dormant in the wintertime. And so they've got to be able to get out and forage for food during the year.
Those
temperatures will make a difference with that.
Good. I guess there's something good from winter up here.
Yes, there is. But I'll right, still let you have the winter. I'll take my fire ants. This is a manual that basically is for nursery stock, grass sod, and related materials. These have the quarantine treatments if you are in an area where you have fire ants that you need to go through, and this is a manual that you need to refer to. I'm going to go ahead and say now, you're going to see web addresses through here that are long, that the government uses. At the very end of this, I have the one site. I think Chris has set you up a very small web address that you can look. But if you will Google USDA APHIS fire ant quarantine, you can get all of these in the site I'm going to show you at the end. So we'll pass on over the beginning of this. If you go into this manual, the one that's currently up now, you're going to see a list of authorized insecticides in there. Take a red pen and make a big X through this part of that page, because you can see it was updated January 2015. If you'll go to another site that I'll give you later on, there is a current list from January 2017. With the products that are available currently. Products come and go so fast, we can't keep up with all of them. So Anne Marie tries to keep a current list up there. Unfortunately for you guys, this has all the nursery products on here, plus it has hay products and all the products for all the quarantines. So you have to be careful when you read this. They may not work for you in your particular situation. So let's talk a little bit about some of your stock now. If you have nursery stock in containers, there are three ways you can go about making sure you can ship these out of the fire ant quarantine zone. You can use an immersion or dip treatment, and this is not really common for containerized stock. You can use a drench treatment, or you can use incorporation of granular insecticides into potting media. Let's take a look at the immersion or dip treatment. There are two insecticides that are approved for this use pattern, either bifenthrin or chlorpyrifos. We're going to cover this once. We're going to cover it real quick. You wouldn't want to go out and fry a turkey and pour a whole lot of peanut oil in that hot pot and then stick your turkey down in it and then have the peanut oil overflow. The best way to do that is to put your turkey in first, fill up your plank with water, take your turkey out, and you know how much peanut oil to put in there when you're cooking. Well, it's the same thing with your plants. You want to make sure you got an immersion tank that will accept the plants that you're going to put in there. When you immerse the plants, the one thing you want to remember is to allow those plants to stay in that solution until the bubbling ceases. If you have plastic containers that have drain holes, you don't have to remove those before immersion, but you need to leave everything in there until the bubbling ceases and that product thoroughly saturates the media in the containers. This is going to be essential. That's what makes your quarantine treatment work well. If you use chlorpyrifos, if you use it at the recommended rate, you can get a certification period of 30 days. If you use bifenthrin, depending on the rate that you use, you can get a certification rate from 60 days up to 180 days. And I guess this will depend on what you're wanting to do in your greenhouse and how long you're going to hold these plants. But your exposure period at that time, once you have treated these plants, they're certifiable upon the completion of treatment and they're ready to ship out of the quarantine zone. You can also use a drench treatment for your container plants, and there are two insecticides approved for this. Again, bifenthrin and chlorpyrifos. You're going to see a trend as we go through here, bifenthrin and chlorpyrifos. But if you're using bifenthrin, you're going to have to look and determine the dry weight bulk density of your potting media so you'll know how much to mix to put in there. There is a protocol in the manual on page 17 of how to determine bulk density. The best thing to do is contact your state regulatory official prior to collecting samples and ask them if they have a protocol and figure out how much this will cost. If your state does not provide a specific protocol for sample collection, the USDA has put one on page 17, so you'll know what to do. For the drench treatment, you need to determine how much treatment solution you're going to need per container. Then you need to determine the total solution required for whatever number of pots you have out there and calibrate your equipment. One thing you have to remember is the volume of the treating solution must be 1/5 of the volume of the media in the container. That is absolute. Basically, you're going to go to runoff, and if it's runoff before you get to 1/5 of the volume, you still need to continue to apply the product until you do. If you don't get runoff, I would highly suggest go ahead and adding a little extra. That is the minimum that they want to put on there. To give you a little example of this, a trade container basically is approximately 3 quarts. And if you fill that container within 1 inch of the top, and then figure the volume of a cylinder, what you're going to find out is that 1/5 of that volume of those 3 quarts is going to be about 19 ounces of material. And for most of us out here doing this, calibrating is going to be taking your sprayer that you're going to use to put that product into pots and counting how long it takes to put 19 seconds in a pot. That's basically the easiest way to do this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in one pot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And it's easier to work that way if you just figure out how much time it takes. And again, with chlorpyrifos, depending on which product you use, depends on how much your mixing is going to take, but the certification period is 30 days for chlorpyrifos and 180 days if you use bifenthrin. You don't have a longer period with that. And again, you got to mix your bifenthrin based on your bulk density that you have of your media mix. Again, your exposure period, your plants are certifiable once you complete this treatment and make sure that the product is completely throughout your media. The other way you can go about this is to incorporate granular insecticides into your potting media. There are 3 insecticides approved for this, but guess what? 2 of them aren't available on the market at this point in time. I copied this directly out of the manual so you could see some of the things that you run into. So we're looking at bifenthrin here as our product. Remember this, if you have your media prepared by someone off-site, Another company mixes this media for you, adds the bifenthrin in there. Once the media is prepared and the insecticide is incorporated, your clock starts ticking on your certification period. So once you get this back, you want to use it as fast as possible to get the maximum use out of it. And again, you need to determine how long a certification period you require for your nursery stock that you're potting. Bulk density is going to come into this too, but you're going to understand the difference in timing here in a minute. Again, with your bulk density, you can put these in at several dose rates with bifenthrin, from a dose rate of 10, 12, 15, or 25 parts per million. And the reason you have a variant in there is because if you use 10 parts per million, you have a certification period of 6 months. If you use 12 parts per million, your certification period is 12 months. 15, you have 24-month certification period. I'm not going to talk about 25 because you have to have a fire ant-free nursery program set up to use the continuous. But again, once you mix these up with your media, your plants are certifiable upon completion of treatment and for, depending on how long you've had them, 6, 12, or 24 months. If you have to repot your plants, if the plants go longer than 24 months, when the plant is potted up, if you pot it up with media with newly incorporated insecticide, you extend that certification period depending on how much you have in your newly incorporated media. But what this is going to illustrate is the importance of record keeping so you can ensure that certification and verify that these plants, even though they have been repotted several times, they were repotted on time and they were repotted with a media that was treated. That way you can extend your certification and not have to go, oops, I can't prove to you that I did that, so I'm going to have to retreat all of these plants again. If you do let something expire, there are two methods that you can use. You can treat with an approved drench, wait the reentry period, and then pot up as usual with media treated with granular insecticide for the certification period that you desire. Or you can pot up the plants in non-treated media and then use an approved drench, and these plants will be improved for the length of time that that drench will cover. For field-grown ball and burlap stock, there are three methods for treating these. Two are post-harvest, one is pre-harvest. The post-harvest treatments are immersion and dip, again with bifenthrin and chlorpyrifos, and a drench with chlorpyrifos. I'm going to wait and we'll discuss the pre-harvest here in a second. You see the question marks at the chlorpyrifos. For the immersion treatment, you need to choose, with the pots, a tank that will work. You immerse the plants. Do not remove the burlap, but immerse the balls so they're completely covered. And again, the whole key is to wait until the solution stops bubbling and the material has had a chance to completely soak down into that root ball. Again, with chlorpyrifos, with the dip treatment, you can get 30 days, and depending on your bifenthrin concentration, you can get 60 to 180 days of treatment. And again, once you have dipped the plants, make sure they've quit bubbling. Your plants are certifiable upon completion of the treatment. There's also a drench method for your plants. There's only one insecticide approved for this use pattern. That's chlorpyrifos. You need to determine the amount of treating solution per root ball. Again, the amount is 1/5 or 20% of the root ball. But for this, you can't use just a simple cylinder form. You're going to have to find the volume for a cone, which is fairly complicated. But I think if you Google volume for cone, you can find that on the internet, and you can figure how much you'll need to put in on to each plant. But this is going to require that algebra that you thought you didn't need in high school. Your treatments for your plants here with the drench method, you have 30-day certification period. So you want to do this right before you ship them. And again, these plants are certifiable upon completion of the treatment. Now for in-field treatment, the traditional method was to apply bait. The baits are listed here, which is one of the reasons that I mentioned baits earlier. And then apply chlorpyrifos granular. But since May 2013, at this point in time, we don't have any chlorpyrifos labels with this use pattern or rate of application. So this is not one that you can use. However, in preparing for this and another seminar that I did on nurseries, I did talk with Anne-Marie Calcott. Again, for nursery containers, you have to do the treatments that we said before. But she told me that I was right to encourage the use of baits on properties to maintain clean stock, clean shipping, and clean holding areas, and to try to keep those fire ant numbers down on your properties, which is one of the reasons that I went into how to use baits and why they're important a little earlier in the talk. And again, if you want to apply these baits, they are particular as far as the equipment you need to put them out at a 1 to 1.5 pound rate. And again, they have to be applied when the temperatures are correct. For your greenhouse grown plants, anything that's grown in a greenhouse or certifiable without an insecticidal treatment, if the inspector determines that your greenhouse is constructed of fiberglass, glass, or plastic in such a way that fire ants are physically excluded and cannot become established with inside the enclosure. That's pretty much most of your good greenhouses. But if you're working in slat houses, shade houses, or open greenhouses, these are not going to qualify as a physical barrier, so plants grown in these must be treated with one of the approved insecticide treatments that we've covered earlier before they can be sold. And the reason you want to do that is this is free advertising that you really don't want. I don't know if you guys saw this just last week in the news, but this is the headline from Delaware. Nasty red imported fire ants make appearance in Delaware. What happened was there a nursery in Delaware that brought in some palm trees from Florida. And Anne-Marie tells me that palm trees are particularly bad about having fire ants make it through the quarantine process. I don't know why. But you can see the kind of press that you get. These tiny fireballs were detected during a routine check at a business. And what the problem is that you will run into if that happens, a hold and control order was probably issued and a treatment program is underway. Pretty much, I don't think they'll be buying from that nursery. This is not the sign you want outside of your nursery. You don't want it protected by fire ants. You want to be able to say, I'm clean and I can ship. I mentioned the website a while ago that if you Google fire ant, USDA aphids fire ant quarantine, this is where you will go. If you'll scroll down on this particular page, and I think this is the page that Chris has linked for you, these are the links to everything that I've talked about today. You can find pretty much everything that you need for fire ants and nurseries. And Chris, I think I made it almost.
Fantastic. No, fantastic timing. Well done. And we've got a couple of questions. You didn't use the word resistance at all, even though we have kind of a limited number of active ingredients mm-hmm. applied for a long time period. Have you encountered any resistant populations amongst your fire ant friends?
None whatsoever that I have found, especially with the baits and not with the others. Basically, since you have a queen that gets down in the mound, and that mound can last up to 7 years, the genetic mixing that you get, once you kill the queen, you kill the colony. So they don't have the chance to get up and mate. There was actually a USDA publication that said they had a new product for resistant insects such as, and they listed fire ants. And I emailed everybody that I knew yesterday and said, do you know of anything about resistance in fire ants? And the answer I got from everyone was no. You just don't get the genetic mixing to carry those resistant genes to other populations.
Well, that's good to know. Now, okay, suppose I'm a grower in Illinois, a state that you said doesn't have to worry about fire ants because of temperature, if nothing else, and I bring in a truckload of something from down in Alabama, and I find some ants, either a lot or a little. What do I have to do, or what should I do?
You need to either treat that shipment or send it back immediately.
Is it a concern?
Yes, it is. Even though you're up there, if you ship those out, number one, they can last through the summer. You don't know if you have a breeding population when you get them in there, but any shipment that I got that I had coming from the southern tier of states, especially if it was someone that I didn't know about, the best way to do that is put a couple of pieces of hot dog around on your shipment and if you have fire ants at about 15 or 20 minutes, you'll find out because they'll be drawn to that fire ant. They like the oil in there. But those products need to be treated. As you can see in Delaware, they have a cease and desist order of them selling anything, and they have to treat everything to make sure it's fire ant free before they can get out of the hold where they can't sell anything else.
All right. But considering how widespread fire ants are and how many good big nurseries that there are down south, Florida up through the southeast, shipping product north, the quarantine seems to work really well, and growers seem to take it really seriously. They're doing a good job. Would you agree?
Yes, I would agree. In fact, we're working with one of the nurseries down here. We actually have a new ant that's going to be worse than fire ants in nurseries if it gets out, called the Tony Crazy Ant.
What?
Yes, and they will actually run fire ants off. They come in numbers like you wouldn't believe, and I think their range may be more southern than the fire ant, but where a couple of the nurseries now are providing is some of those pre-mixed potting mix that they have, where we're trying to run some tests to see if that fire ant quarantine protocols that we have will work with the Tony crazy ant.
What kind of crazy ant?
T-A-W-N-Y, Tony.
Tony. Thought it was a call me crazy ant. Well, that's just what we need, folks. Gracious, I'm really going to watch out where I'm stepping next time I'm down south. We don't have any more questions, but if you have more questions, you can call or email both Dr. Graham, Fudd Graham. There's his contact information. And you mentioned Anne Marie Calcott a couple of times. She's in Biloxi, Mississippi. And we do have one more question. We can get this one real quick. This is Virginia again. Do you need to be concerned, Fudd, about a reduced effectiveness when you're potting up and augmenting your old media?
No, not if you're potting up and you put the newly mixed product around the outside, that should take care. They won't stay just in the middle, so you shouldn't have any problems when you pot up like that.
There you go. Well, at least we got good control for these suckers. And we mentioned the resources. I tested both of these out. articles.extension.org/fire_ants will take you to some articles from Extension, I presume. And then the big long one you had in here, Fudd, that takes you to that good resource page from the USDA, I shortened down to tinyurl.com/imported-fire-ants.
Let me make a point on these. That first one, the articles.extension.org fire ants, is more for homeowners and other people like that. It will cover some nursery things, but it is put together, and if you need information on fire ants and products and things like that too, things that you think might work, we actually have a page of, how should we say, mystical fire ant
treatment?
Treatments, yes. Yeah, using magic in other forms, and whether they work or not. But it is put together by all of the fire ant experts across the southeast, from Clemson all the way across to Texas A&M. And so it's sort of got the best of the best of all of us in there.
Some people fight fire with fire. I don't know if you want to do that one or not, but I've seen that done before in my time.
That's on the magical page.
Oh, there you go. All right. And there's always the anteater, if as this cartoon indicates.
Unfortunately, the anteater usually eats termites. But
yeah, there is. And would they eat a fire ant, or would it sting his feet?
It would probably sting most. Most places where anteaters come from, they call termites white ants.
Ah, see, another old wives' tale dispelled today. All right, well, if you want to listen to this webinar again, or share it with colleagues, fellow nursery owners, maybe your supplier down south, we're going to have it archived as soon as possible this afternoon at the same place you signed up for it, conveniently enough, fallpublishing.com/webinars. I've got a couple more coming up the next two Thursdays in a row, July 6th and July 13th. Ellen Wells and I are going to be covering the best of the new varieties for 2018 that we saw out at the California Spring Trials. So be sure to sign up for that, and they're guaranteed to be ant-free. And one last thanks to our generous sponsor, BASF, who puts the free in free webinar. So we greatly appreciate that. Fudd, I want to thank you for the great time we had today. I tell you, as somebody who grew up down south, I found it fascinating to learn more about fire ants. But again, I'm glad I'm up here. I'm glad I'm not, that's not my shoe. But for Fudd and all of his fire ant friends, who they did a great job keeping it quiet in your office. Give them a try as soon as we're done here for the, keeping it down. For all of them and for all of my my folks here at Ball Publishing who are glad they live in Illinois where they don't have to worry about fire ants, I'm Chris Beatty saying, so long, everybody.